Just wanted to reinforce as well the power of having people that have walked the walk talk to people that are facing it or have been there. I fairly quickly learned, probably not fast enough in my own practice, that the example I can give you is a young mother, no risk factors, delivered a Down's baby. I had a woman in my practice who had a 30-year-old Down's at home. I contacted both of them and had this mother who looked after her Down son for 30 years, and they went out for lunch and talked about how and the challenges of raising a Down's child. And the mother came back and said, that was, there's no bull crap. The mother who'd been through it for 30 years is able to tell you, this kid is not gonna be a nuclear scientist, but they're the most loving, caring kids, and it's a wonderful, wonderful tool to have them walk through that. Now, you're probably wondering, you've been putting up with me all day here, wondering who I am, what I'm doing up here. I'm from Kitchener-Waterloo, and I was in family practice for pretty close to 45 years, but I got interested in humor in 1988, I should mention it may be interesting to you people as well that I have a neurological disease myself, and it was 1988 when I was diagnosed with CIDP, chronic inflammatory demyelinating polyneuropathy. Put that one in your Scrabble thing. There was only 15 cases in North America at that time, and I'm still on immune suppressants for that. It may be why you may notice I walk a little slowly and hang on to things. So it was quite an adjustment for me. I had not missed a day of school, high school, university, or medical practice in 45 years, and I was in a wheelchair for about 6 weeks, and they weren't sure I was going to walk again. I've had to give up some things, but I'm still biking and swimming and doing what I can. I take my son golfing, pay his green fees, and he beats me. There's just no, these young people. So what I want to do, and I can see more as I sat through some of your sessions, how my particular topic fits in. I'm not going to say that you're going to laugh yourself and get rid of your brain tumors. And you may think, brain tumors and humor? Wait a minute here. Seem to be at odds. But hopefully, by the time I'm finished, you may appreciate that this is just another tool that we don't use enough in when we're dealing with this kind of a journey. And I basically set myself six separate goals. Number one is to have fun, which allows me to tell you about the young lady stopped for speeding recently on the 401. Very serious OPP constable is writing her a ticket. And he looks in her eyes and he said, your eyes are kind of red. Have you been drinking as well as speeding? She looks him in the eye and said, your eyes are glazed. Have you had a donut? He'd either get four more tickets or he'd say, get out of here. I'm going to talk about why I think it's good for you and some of the research that's been done. And believe me, I took a lot of flack when I started this in 88. My medical colleague said, oh, it's anecdotal. There's no scientific evidence. Well, we now have a lot of scientific evidence. I will talk about the negative stereotypes that are still out there about humor. I'm going to ask you to get in touch with your inner child. And I don't care if you're 2 or 92. We still all have an inner child deep in us that likes to come out and play. I'm going to talk about, and this has been mentioned several times in the sessions today, about the science of psychoneuroimmunology, the mind-body connection. How does your emotional state impact on your immune state, your physical state, your spiritual state? And now we've got evidence to prove that that's the case. And finally, I hope to leave some concrete methods and clues to bring more vitamin H for humor into your own lives. Don Ardell said, the heaviest moments require the lightest touch. And probably some of our panelists mentioned when you hear that first diagnosis of brain cancer, it's got to be probably the heaviest moment in your life. But Winston Churchill also said that in order to deal with the most serious things in life, you must also understand the most amusing, both sides of the coin. George Bernard Shaw also said that life does not cease to be funny when people die any more than it ceases to be serious when we laugh. And I think we have to look at that carefully. John Dewey also said, it is possible to be playful and serious at the same time. And in fact, it represents the ideal mental condition. Joel Goodman, who is the head of the Humour Project in New York, also said that humour is laughter made from pain, not pain inflicted by laughter. He also said that laughter is a wonderful way of preventing a hardening of the attitudes. And attitude is very, very important. Jenny Banks also said, laughter will help inoculate you against the grumps and will decrease the number of scowl movements you have each day. Michael Pritchard, and I have some rural roots. I spent 6 summers on a dairy farm as a teenager. Laughter is like manure to a farmer. It doesn't do any good until you spread it around. And that pile of manure behind the barn doesn't do anything until you spread it on the fields, and then things start to happen. You can do the same with a smile, with a joke, with some reassurance to that friend, what we call the ripple effect. If it made you feel good, it may make someone else feel good as well. Henry Ward Beecher also said that a person without a sense of humor is like a wagon without springs, jolted by every pebble in the road. And I believe that our sense of humor is our natural built-in shock absorber. It's there for a reason, and we'll talk more about that. And honestly, it also been said that laughter is a universal uniter. And believe me, and I'm sure our panelists and anybody who's been through the brain tumor journey will tell you how important it is to unite your doctor, your oncologist, your radiologist, your nurses, your spouse, your children, your family, so they're all on the same page. And one of the quickest ways to do that is with a bit of humor. People have also asked me why I got into this, and I can tell you about a true incident. This happened 25 years ago, week before Christmas. I was having a bad day in the office. I was behind. I had a headache. And I walked in to see a mother who brought her 5-year-old son in. And this kid was not a happy camper. He'd been up all night with an earache, and he was already underneath the examining table screaming. And I thought, oh, this is going to improve my day. Well, I finally got him out. I managed to get a look in his ears. But I knew he was upset. So I turned to him and I said, now, what did you ask Santa for Christmas next week? He looked me straight in the eye and said, a new doctor. And I went back to write up his chart. And I thought, my headache's gone. I feel better. And all I did was have a quick, spontaneous laugh for a few seconds, and it completely changed my mood. It has that power. I had an old gentleman before I officially retired from my family practice that nailed me. And if you asked me, I would have said this gentleman was a bit of a grouch, but I happened to walk into the examining room to find him already stretched out my examining room table. He'd taken the sheet we provided and pulled it right over his body, and he'd brought in a sign he'd made up that it stuck on his chest that said, too late. And I can tell you, he got an extra 20 minutes out of me that day because he made me laugh. And I'm telling the public, take some humor into your doctors. They're all stressed out. They're working in a system that is tough. We know when you should get your MRI, when you should see the specialist, when you should get your surgery, but we have to fight for it. And it puts a lot of stress on the doctors and their staff. And you take in a bit of humor, you will get better medical care. I guarantee it. So take that. And actually, I also had an incident where I walked in, a patient of mine turned to me and said, doctor, what do you find in a clean nostril? I said, I don't know. He said, fingerprints. I said, not bad. I also point out to you, a 6-year-old child that can tell their doctor a joke. I like that kid. Positive self-esteem, self-assertive, and probably in the top 10% in the intelligence quotient. I have done a fair bit of speaking to seniors groups, so they've shared stories for me as well. You probably heard about the 95-year-old gentleman who streaked naked through the flower show, got first prize for best dried arrangement. It's a bit of a visual there, and it's not pretty. I also heard the story about the older gentleman that came in to see the doctor with a sore ear. Doctor looked in his ear and pulled out a Gravol suppository. The doctor said, what on earth are you doing with a suppository in your ear? He said, now I know where my hearing aid is. It's a bit of a crappy story, but I like it. I also heard a 104-year-old lady interviewed, and the interviewer said, "Now, what's good about being 104? She said, "No peer pressure." And I said, I like that lady as well. I also, in a line I like from Rodney Dangerfield, he said, "I've gotten so old, I've given up sex for food. In fact, I've now put a mirror over my kitchen table." Little subtle things that kind of get you smiling. Now, William James is often referred to as the father of modern North American psychology, and I've got his tomes at home. They're huge books. But in one of them, he says, "The greatest discovery of my generation is that a person can alter their life by altering their attitude." He also said, "We don't laugh because we're happy. We're happy because we laugh." And if you're in a bad mood and you hope the world's going to cheer you up, it often won't do it. If you go to your special laughter buddy, think of your own embarrassing moments, pick up a Herman book, whatever, to get you smiling, bingo, then you will start to feel better. They also talk about laughter being a form of catharsis, which of course is the medical term for a laxative, which allows me to tell you about the 8-foot-6-inch bureaucrat who died. They couldn't find a coffin big enough, so they gave him an enema and put him in a shoebox. Makes me feel better. Also, we maybe need to look back to our childhood. They've done some very interesting studies. Alvin Schultz said laughter is the natural sound of childhood, and we'll be mentioning that shortly. They've done studies watching kids play in a daycare center or a playground, and these are psych students, social students, with their stopwatches. Kids that age may giggle or laugh anywhere from 1 to 2 to 3 to 4 to 5 100 times every day. The average adult laughs 12 to 15 times a day. How did we get from 500 to 15? What do kids hear when they laugh? You've all heard it. "You laugh too long. You laugh too hard. It wasn't all that funny. Wipe that smirk off your face. Get serious. Grow up." We've heard it, haven't we? What's the message to the child? Don't laugh. And somehow they learn it. The other place where I've seen laughter used as a stress releaser, and I wish I could have videotaped this. We don't do it anymore, but for about 25 years, all of the high school students had to come in and see their family doctor and have a physical before they got into high school. Now, the 13 or 14-year-old girl that comes in to see their male doctor for a physical is just a tad uptight. And you ask them, "How did your summer go?" "I had a good summer, thank you, doctor." The puberty giggles. Go by any grade 7 and 8 school and watch them. What's happening? Their body is changing through puberty so quickly that it changes their relationship to their parents, their siblings, and their peers. And nature recognizes this and says, "You need more laughter." And we make fun of them again. It's nature's way of handling that stress. I like to ask people as well, think of your very best friends. They are usually people you can laugh with, right? You don't spend time with people that make you feel miserable by choice. You're stuck with the relatives. Now, is everybody still awake? I want laughter, the shortest distance between two people. Victor Borg. This is Dr. Annette Goodhart. Think about how you feel when you have a good laugh. I only play this for an hour, so get comfortable. Why buy expensive toys? Another one called the quad.
That is going to make him laugh now. Ready?
Mark Twain, against the assault of laughter, nothing can stand. A couple of observations when you watch those. First of all, can anybody here convince me that those children laughing were taught how to do that? No. Hardwired, part of your brain from birth. So it's there. All right. Evolution is there. Everything has a reason. So we have to analyze, okay, why is it there? What's it for? The other thing that I think was demonstrated beautifully by the child with the paper, what happens physiologically when you laugh? Boom, you fall over. You cannot contract your skeletal muscles and laugh mirthfully at the same time. It is physiologically impossible. If you're like me and you make your first trip to Buckingham Palace and the guard is standing at attention, what do? Try to make them laugh, right? So, it is a very powerful muscle relaxant. How do you feel after a good laugh? Mellow, relaxed, compassionate, good listener. I realize that I really, if possible, I should have a good laugh before I walk in to see every one of my patients. Because what it does is get rid of any agenda I have. If I am tense, frustrated, anxious, uptight, gone. And actually, one of the other concrete things I would mention to you, I had all my examining rooms full of the Herman cartoon series, Calvin and Hobbes, and The Far Side. It was not unusual for me to walk in and the patients are giggling looking at Herman cartoons. We have a choice. You can look at McLean's or Time magazine with the latest political scandals, suicide bombings, etc., or you can giggle. And I also point out that while you're looking at cartoons, you are not aware you're waiting. You think about it. Laughter is the primary outer manifestation of joy. Barbara Friedrichsen is a world expert on joy, and she looked at the 10 most common positive emotions: joy, gratitude, serenity, interest, hope, pride, amusement, inspiration, awe, and love. Joy will be different for all of you, depending on your gender, your religion, your physical health, your mental health, and your spiritual health. But here is a picture of joy, which seems to be very appropriate right now. Think if he's having some fun. I think there's a little bit of joy there. Away we go into the pile of leaves. We seem to get a lot of humor out of religion. Just because illness enters our lives does not mean joy has to exit. Edward Lee. And I think that includes even having a brain tumor. Yes, it's a disease and an illness, but that doesn't mean joy has to exit your life. First Baptist Church, Reverend John Smith, 9 a.m. service, Jesus walks on water. 11 a.m. service, searching for Jesus. So it was an actual sign in front of a church in South Carolina. Here's another one with a slightly mixed message. Sign outside a church. The Anglican Church welcomes you. The premises are protected by guard dogs. What soap is to the body, laughter is to the soul. We know that soap washes the sweat and the dirt and the grime from your body. I believe that laughter is there to wash the stress, anxiety, tension, and frustration from your soul. Sign in a newspaper, missing one dog, faded brown with bald spots, blind in the left eye, missing right ear, missing left hind leg, broken tail, answers to the name Lucky. Somebody said, I missed one line, recently castrated, but now I do get people that come up to me and say, I can't remember jokes. I guess I don't have a sense of humor. That is not what we're talking about. What we're talking about is just giving yourself permission in your mind to have fun and look for the incongruities in life. And I must admit, I drove by this particular sign every morning making rounds for about 6 months before I finally remembered my camera. Subtle, but it's there. 495 Park Street, Dr. J. Wittig, Dr. J. R. Sale, Obstetrics and Gynecology, entrance at rear. I pointed this out to Jack. He said, gosh, I never thought of that. We still have people coming in the front door. Local police station vandalized. Vandals entered local police station and moved all the toilet seats. Thus far, police have nothing to go on. You can't have fun with the English language. Local hospital notice on the only elevator to exit their psychiatric unit. Three loonies required to exit the parking lot. It's not politically correct, but I like it. I should also point out that it's now up to four loonies as well. Sign in a repair shop. We can repair anything. Please knock hard on the door as the bell doesn't work. Love it. Excuse notes written by parents to their children's teachers. Dear school, please excuse John being absent on January 28, 29, 30, 31st, 32nd, and 33rd. Please excuse Ray Friday. He had very loose vowels. And this last one is an image. Please excuse Tom being absent yesterday. He had diarrhea and his boots leak. Have you all got an image of that last little kid there? Give him the week off, no problem. Humor and advertising. Sign in a music store. Gone chopping me back on a minuet. Frozen food ad. The best meals you ever thaw. Sign in a diet clinic. A word to the wide should be sufficient. Advertisers starting to recognize how much more powerful your advertising is with a bit of humor. I'm thinking of the IKEA commercials, etc. If there's some humor in it and people have to process it, it is much more powerful. Here are some examples. Nichols Plumbing, don't sleep with the drip, call. These people got my business. I had a hot water tank blow, and I remembered their sign. This sign has been up for about 10 years. Don't free beer during Leafs playoff games. They didn't want to have to get a ladder and change the sign, so. We are not immune to this as doctors. In hospital charts, history was shot, patient was shot in head with a .32 caliber rifle. Chief complaint, headache. Patient sent to hospital for erosion of cervix by a local medical doctor. And dictated, patient had a pap smear today. Transcribed, patient had a pap smear today. I have also seen a classic that was actually written in a hospital chart that said the following. Rectal examination disclosed a normal-sized thyroid. Since the thyroid is a gland in your neck, that's one hell of a finger, one hell of a rectal. That's all I can tell you. Definition of humor. Humor is perspective. It gives you the ability to separate the situation from the self. The situation, your job, should be taken seriously. The self is separate and should be taken lightly. Nancy Sullivan. And humor will be different, as I said, for all of you. Clive James also said that common sense and sense of humor are really the same thing, moving at different speeds. Sense of humor is common sense dancing. I also had a good example of this a number of years ago. I came home from work one day, got the inevitable question from my wife. She said, how did your day go? And I said, well, actually, I was involved in a cardiac arrest this morning at the hospital, and we managed to save a gentleman's life. She said, that's wonderful, dear. Now take out the garbage. So you can do CPR. The garbage still isn't going to walk out by itself, dum-dum. So it takes you back to basics. They've also classified humor in different groups. First is that of spontaneous wit, and these are the people that think of that one-liner that you and I think of next week. One of the best I've heard was a speaker in the States, 400 people. The MC is up on a raised podium. The guest speaker is down on the floor with a handheld microphone ready to go. His turn comes to speak. He leaps up on the stage, misses the top step, and does a face plant in front of 400 people. He didn't get up. He looked out at the audience and said, I'll now take questions from the floor. I might think of that a week later if I was lucky. Second is that of humor Aikido. And Aikido is the Japanese martial arts, been around for about 2,000 years, learning to defend themselves, but they also learn to not hurt their opponent. A little more subtle. Best give you an example of this that comes from my own teenage years. My parents were quite playful. My father traveled a fair bit, came back from a business trip in the States, and he had quite a good-sized bruise in his arm, and he flaunted this in front of my mother for several days. Finally, she said, "All right, where did you get the bruise?" "Oh, that was the blonde in Baltimore. She bit me in a moment of violent passion." My mother looked him straight in the eye and said, "You mean at your age you got one with teeth?" You know you have been had. Third is that of embarrassment. I've done quite a bit of public speaking, and I've noticed that one of the groups that hates to be embarrassed is that teenage group. You know, you'll speak to them and you'll tell something funny and you'll see them look at someone else to see if they're laughing before they'll laugh. What, however, happens to your embarrassing moments as you grow older? They become stories that you tell your friends about, right? You get smileys out of life's embarrassing moments. I have picked up a couple examples. One of them was a story told to me about a woman getting dressed one morning, having trouble with the zipper in her dress, and asked hubby to help. Well, you women know what men are like. He took the zipper, up, down, up, down, up, down. She finally said, "Leave me alone, I have to go to work." And off she went. She came home about 5 o'clock and pulled in the driveway and looked and thought, ooh, there's her husband on a dolly underneath the car fixing it. And there was no one around. She tiptoed around, grabbed the zipper on his fly and went, up, down, up, down, up, down. Ran in the house and found her husband sitting at the kitchen table. And she said, "Who's in the driveway?" "Oh, that's Larry, the new neighbor. He's fixing the car." They went out to apologize to Larry, but they didn't have to worry. He was unconscious. He's head at the bottom of the car. And personally, my kind of neighborhood. I also spoke to a rural group and had a farm wife come up and tell me an absolute, I don't know how you'd make up a story like this. Young couple out at a fairly formal dinner one night. Halfway through the dinner, the husband was not feeling well, and he nipped out to the washroom. Well, unfortunately, he had a bit of diarrhea, and he didn't quite make it to the can. He is standing there with his ointed underwear thinking, what am I going to do now? Oh, we men are very resourceful. Pulls his pants on, rolls the underwear up, puts it in his pocket, and goes back out to finish dinner. That's what you do, guys, right? No problem. They get home that night, and the wife is watching him undress, and she said, "Where is your underwear?" He said, a bit of an accident there in the washroom, but he said, "Hey, I'm a cool dude." He said, pants on, underwear in pocket. When I got back out to the table and no one was looking, I just discreetly slipped them into your purse. She said, "Dear, I did not take a purse tonight." When I heard that story, I started asking my male patients, would you know which purse your wife took out on a particular evening? Not a chance. So some woman got home that night and opened up, geez, I scared the crap out of some guy tonight. So my message is, the more embarrassing it is, the more likely you'll be laughing about it later on. Fourthly, that of ridicule or toxic humor. As we mentioned, laughter is humor made from pain, not pain inflicted by laughter. And laughing with people leaves them with a whole self-esteem. Laughing at them leaves them with a hole in their self-esteem. And finally, that of parody, which uses humor to instruct. I can best give you an example of this that comes from my medical background. One of the pediatricians who shared his true story. He's on call one night for the pediatric group. Got an urgent call at 4 o'clock in the morning, which you'd kind of hope was a kid with, you know, severe asthma or croup. This mother's urgent problem at 4 a.m. was whether she could start her 5-month-old on vegetables. He was very polite, answered her questions, didn't say anything. But what he did do was, the next night he set his alarm for 4 o'clock, called her back and said, "I was thinking about your call the other night. You can start meats too." Can't fault him, can you? This year, thousands of men will die from stubbornness. No, we won't. This was a professional sign in the States encouraging men to get physical checkups, but you can see what they think of it. We now have some functional MRIs on the anatomy of humor. Small studies. It's hard to get grants for studies of humor. This comes from Stanford and Dartmouth in the States. What they wanted to know was what parts of the brain were functioning when we laugh. This next slide is busy, but I can summarize it fairly quickly for you. Three things. They found that the neocortex, the right frontal lobe generally, is the part of the brain that interpret the humor, but the part of the brain that decided whether it was funny or not was separate, and that was in the insular, or the amygdala. So we have two separate areas, one interpreting and one deciding whether it's funny. Secondly, the nucleus accumbens is the area that lights up when people are laughing, watching at cartoons or sitcoms, and it's the same area that lights up when drug addicts get high. Thirdly, women are much more intellectual about humor. And I think anecdotally we know this. They access their memory and their language area before deciding whether to laugh. How many women here rushed out to see the latest Three Stooges movie? I haven't had any women admit it yet. Slapstick humor, my wife always say, that must hurt. Who's going to clean up that mess? Women will make humor and fun of choices people make, but not make fun of things they can't change. So we're probably going to get more information on this. This is the work of Stanley Tan and Lee Burke in Loma Linda, California, the hypothalamic pituitary adrenal axis. We all know about the fight or flight mechanism. We know that when you're frightened, your blood pressure goes up, your pulse goes up, your cortisol levels go up. They want to know what happened when you laughed. And what they did was take university students and measured baselines of neuropeptides. We've talked about those today as well. Serotonin, dopamine, endorphins, noradrenaline, and then had them watch comedy movies and went back and remeasured. Cortisol levels drop with mirthful laughter, so that indicates that it's stress relieving. They also looked at components of the immune system, IgM. They looked at plasma cytokine gamma interferon. They looked at plasma IgG. They looked at, and all of these things go up with mirthful laughter and stay up for quite a while afterwards. We also, so your a good laugh boosts your immune system. We also now have a textbook called The Psychology of Humor by Rod Martin. He's a PhD psychologist. It's a very academic book. I've read it. And what he found, he took all the anecdotal things about humor that we're aware of and proved them with studies. And what he found was the following. It reduces stress. It boosts the immune system, as we've mentioned. It relieves pain. Your endorphins are markedly increased when you laugh. So there are biochemical reasons for why you feel good after having a good laugh. It decreases anxiety. It stabilizes the mood. It rests the brain. It enhances communication. As I mentioned, a universal uniter. It inspires creativity. There is a connection between ha-ha and aha. When you think of it, when do you think you're most productive? With your boss over your shoulder saying, haven't got that done yet, that's gotta be done, blah, blah, blah. Or after having a good laugh. Pretty simple, I think. It maintains hope and it bolsters morale. So it's a pretty impressive list. And these have all been now scientifically proven with controls, etc. Now, it's nice to talk about the physiology, the anatomy, the biochemistry, classification of humor, but knowledge doesn't do anything unless you can make use of it. And what we did with 15 years ago was set up a humor project at our local hospital. And as Voltaire said, the art of medicine consists of amusing the patient while nature cures the disease. Laughter is good medicine, mind, body, and spirit. We have a group of seniors who've gone to a clown school and make a clown visit on request. Without scary masks. I should also point out now that you can get a BA in therapeutic clowning in Israel, started in 2001. You can get a master's degree in therapeutic clowning. So if your kid's teacher says they're the class clown, you can say, yep, that's what they're gonna be. And believe me, pediatricians especially won't go near a child with an invasive procedure unless the therapeutic clown is there. It doesn't take the pain away, it diverts it. It makes it easier for the patient, it makes it easier for the parents, it makes it easier for the doctor as well. One of our volunteers happens to be a patient of mine. They've given us some feedback as well. Ethel Barrymore said, you cannot pour happiness in others without spilling a few drops on yourself. They go in for an afternoon, take humor material available. We have Herman's books, joke books. We also have four of these carts called Jokes on Spokes. I wanted to call it Snickers for Sickers, but they didn't think that would go over. And this can be wheeled to the patient's bedside and they can watch a comedy movie. It has not cost the healthcare system a nickel. It's all been donated. And hospitals are not happy places. When I came to Kitchener-Waterloo, there were over 600 beds at our major hospital. We now have 300 beds, and our population has tripled since I came to town. So you got to be sicker to get in, and if you're breathing, they throw you out. And you had the choice between counting the holes in the acoustic ceiling above your bed or watching Candid Camera for free. What would you pick? Pretty simple. Lever clamps are something in me. I could really use the money. I actually had a patient use this line on me as I was helping assist on his surgery. You probably also heard, too, about the lawyer who stepped on the cow patty, looked down and said, "My gosh, I'm melting." Makes me feel better. Now, what I want to do... This is Mutsy. I had three or four of these in the office, and I had them in the office for kids that came in, kids that had to have needles, kids that had to have stitches. You can't tell the kids it doesn't hurt. They know it hurts. But you can say, hug this while you have your stitches out. Hold this while you have your needle. I had adult males crying, telling me their problems holding Mutsy. My suggestion to you is, and you probably do this, especially for the pediatrics, if you've got a child that's facing that brain tumor journey, why not have a special friend like this that goes with them everywhere they go? Let them, you know, for radiation, chemo. Even adults, especially that, you know, 2 o'clock in the morning in the hospital, when you're all alone, to have something like this to snuggle up to can be very comforting. So it's one of the concrete suggestions I would make. I'm going to take you off the nitroglycerin pills, one pill too late. I feel a lot better since I ran out of those pills you gave me, and sometimes that's true too. Notice on an obstetrical for our bulletin board, the first 5 months of life are very traumatic. Someone added a PS, the last 5 months ain't so hot either. So there's your entire life on one slide. One of the ways I disappear and get away and rest is I've done a fair bit of Arctic canoeing. This was taken up on the Coogee Sopa River on Baffin Island. My son and I were in the blue tent in the foreground. What I liked about it was my bellboy didn't reach. We also had a canoe and spent a week canoeing down to Lake Harbor. They have a 5-meter tide. My son is 6'1". Tide brings these icebergs in and then goes out and leaves them on the bottom of the bay, and you can walk among them, like walking among clouds. I hadn't learned, this is in the Coppermine River in the Northwest Territories. I'm hanging onto my canoe in the middle. I hadn't learned you're supposed to keep the canoe right side up. I did manage to get through it. Actually, this stretch of water has killed about 12 people in the last 20 years. Those white caps and waves down there are 15 to 20 feet high. I know because I swam through it. If you keep the canoe right side up, it works. I'm in the yellow night jacket running another set of rapids. I have a group of friends we canoe with, 41 years. We got the idea of getting some renal dialysis bags, washing them out, and we have the red wine, the white wine, the rum, and the scotch in the IV bags. And when you want a drink, you just turn the IV on, and you bring the bags home. There's no pollution. We have been written up in several adventure magazines. It's also been said that he with the most toys still dies. And it is not what you have in life, it is who you have in life that's important. My three kids at my daughter Heather's wedding, proud of them. Tracy in red as an occupational therapist. She had a 4-year honors degree from University of Toronto before her 21st birthday. Heather has an honors degree in entomology. She's a bug expert. She's teaching at scientists in the school and in an outdoor ed program. Kevin has an honors degree and a master's in ornithology. He's teaching grades 7 and 8. He was also picked as one of the top 6 university volleyball players in Canada, so you don't want to meet him across a volleyball net. Grandkids, 9 of them, 3 days, a 3-day canoe trip, a little bit of smiles. I'm trying to tell people my age to take your grandkids into the woods. There are kids these days who've never been in the woods, never been in a sleeping bag, never slept in a tent, and they're not going to want to protect it unless they've done it. They grow up quickly. This is taken 2 years later. You can see them changing very quickly. I put this in. Noah's my oldest now. He's 17. First canoe trip in Algonquin Park. Spend time with kids. The only facilities up there are a thunder box, not an outhouse, just a wooden box with a lid. No, I had never used one of these before. Went up and used it the first time and came running back to me really excited. He said, Papa, my poo is on top. I said, your number two is number one. That's why you spend time with children. Principle of inverse paranoia. One should proceed through each day looking for the good that is all around us. You can look for confrontation, you'll find it. But if you look for the positive, it's there. How do you read this next slide? Opportunity is now here, or opportunity is nowhere. May depend on your mood. Children, you bring them into the world and they drive you out of it. Balzac. I'm not worried if I'm not smart enough to get a good job. I can always teach, or love to show that to educational groups. I think you'll find my test results are pretty good indications of your abilities as a teacher. I'm not sure what you say to that one either. Laughter comes naturally. Hate must be taught. I think you would all agree, the quads and the kid with the paper, that that was a natural instinct to laugh. And yet, studies now are taking kids 5 or 6 years of age and showing that they've got prejudice already because of social media, television, sitcoms, etc. Playing with words. During a discussion about the difference between complete and finished, someone suggested this explanation. When you meet the right women, you are complete. If you marry the wrong woman, you are finished. If the right woman finds you with the wrong woman, you are completely finished. Handling toxic humor. It is out there. Some of the comedians in the nightclubs, some of it is very racist or sexist. If you're assertive enough, tell them you don't like it and why you don't like it. They're expecting a reaction, give them no reaction. Ask them to explain the joke. That'll kill it for sure. Simply walk away. The African proverb, the axe forgets, the tree remembers. You don't have to blow out my candle to make your candle glow brighter. And a lot of the reality programs on TV now are win, win, win. And it doesn't matter if you lie, backstab, cheat, as long as you win. And as Ruggie Ramanan said, there's nothing noble about being superior to another person. True nobility is being superior to your former self. That way no one else is hurt. Definition: neurotic, someone who builds dream castles in the air. Psychotic, someone who is into the castle. Psychiatrist, someone who collects the rent. It's for my mother-in-law. Got anything rabid? I put this in for another reason. There's a gender difference in humor as well. I've probably asked over 200,000 people now, has anybody ever, I repeat, ever heard a viable father-in-law joke? Have you heard a couple of mother-in-law jokes? Oh yeah. One I like is the definition of mixed emotions, watching your mother-in-law drive off a cliff in your brand new car. Sexiness wears thin after a while and beauty fades, but married to a man who makes you laugh every day, now that's a real treat. Global giggles. Laughter has no accent. You don't have to speak someone's language in order to laugh with them. My kids have all been involved in this group. This summer, I had an 11-year-old granddaughter in Japan for a month, a 14-year-old in Ecuador, another one in Halifax, and one in London, Ontario. This particular village, we have 60 kids from 15 different countries, two girls, two boys, all 11 with an adult leader, and they spent a month living together, learning about each other's languages, cultures, dress, and food. The idea is if you spend a month with somebody when you're 11, you're not as likely to want to drop bombs on them when you're 22. So it's quite a group. Three events which concern mankind: birth, life, and death. All know nothing of their birth, all submit to die, and many forget to live. Laughter is like changing a baby's diaper. It doesn't change things permanently, but it makes everything okay for a while. For every minute you're angry, you lose 60 seconds of happiness. Ralph Waldo Emerson. Negative people are often described as happiness vampires or suffering from a severe mirth defect. Humor profile. Assess your own humor profile. Where do you laugh the most? At home, at work, alone, or in company? Most of us would agree you laugh in company. You often cry alone. And you can go to those situations, that sitcom, those cartoon books, the funny emails. Phone up your laughter buddy and consciously seek out more laughter. Adding more vitamin H to your life, Smile more often. Fake it until you make it. You ever stood in front of a mirror and started to giggle? Boom. You got yourself going. You got all the benefits. Play with a baby. Play with a kitten or puppy. Phone rings. Smile and then answer the phone. You will give a different response. Go out of character. Change habits. Eat with the opposite hand. Tell someone what you laughed about. Look into a mirror and say, how serious is this? One place you should procrastinate is to delay suffering. Seek out and spend time with laughers. Draw or visualize that one person who is driving you nuts as a clown. Dance naked in front of your pets. Waste some time. Type A behaviors don't know how to do nothing. It's okay to be silly. Sometimes nonsense makes the most sense. Look out for number one and don't step in number two unless you're a lawyer. I also like the Zen Buddha saying that defines the perfect archer as the man who fires his arrow and whatever he hits is his target. You can't fail. Tell a child not to laugh. I often use this in the office. Kids often come into the doctor's office scared, crying. I'd make eye contact and say, now don't smile, don't laugh. I see one starting. You get them laughing and boom, you now can give them better medical care. A day is wasted without laughter, Nicholas Shamford. If you've not laughed recently, you're probably not regular either. If the world was truly logical, men would ride side saddle. Yeah, you got to think about that for a minute, don't you? I always remember there ain't much fun in medicine, but there's a lot of medicine in fun, and I think that's what my overall message is here today. It's a very short leap from humor to compassion. And I learned reasonably quickly that my patients would come in with agendas. Simple agenda was a cough, a rash. The tough agenda was the marriage that was in trouble, their parent been diagnosed with cancer, their kid who might be on drugs. They would not get to talk about those unless they knew you were making eye contact, listening to them, and being compassionate. Humor and stress. Humor is about lightening up. Stress is about tightening up. If you can get to this state of relaxing, you're doing okay. I think he's relaxed. Laughter can take you from moping to coping to hoping, and this is our motto at Joke Junction. And sometimes it can do that in seconds. Aspire to inspire before you expire. Life is not about how many breaths we take, but how many moments that take our breath away. You saw this out the window doing the dishes some night. God's way of saying, have a nice day, a smile in the sky. Don't ever give up. Mr. Frog has decided he's not quite done yet. Now, I know what we're talking about is not rocket science stuff, but I want to make a couple quick points here. Number one is sometimes when you're really upset, turn it over and look at the other side. The story of a fellow who had a good friend opening a new store. Week ahead, he phoned a floral shop, ordered some flowers. Night of the opening, he went around. Of course, he looked for his flowers. Well, he found them, but they had a sign on them saying, rest in peace. He's not impressed. He gets on the phone to the florist, said, this is a happy occasion on the wrong side, rest in peace. I'm sorry, sir. There's obviously been a grave error. But please think of me. I have a phone call to come yet from the family that just buried their loved one with a sign that says, congratulations on your new location. And he realized that he didn't have the problem. The other guy had the problem. And I want to leave you with something called smiling is infectious. You catch it like the flu. When someone smiled at me today, I started smiling too. I passed around the corner and someone saw my grin. When I saw their smile, I realized I'd passed it on to them. I thought about my smile and realized its worth. A single smile just like mine can travel round the earth. So if you feel a smile begin, don't leave it undetected. Let's start an epidemic quick and get the world infected. It's also been said that if laughing together is as close as you can come to a hug without touching, I hope in some way this afternoon we've given every one of you a big, warm hug. Thank you very much.